outside the box of the model. Because, you know, when we think about what an organization's potential is, our organization's potential is, I do not want to create a choir, okay? I want people that are going to push me on my board. This is a partnership. I want people that are fired up. I had a guy, I've got a guy who's employment counsel at Netflix on my board, and I went into his office on Saturday, or on Friday. He works at Netflix too. Went on Friday, and he was kind of like, listen, here's what I'm thinking. You need to do this, and how about this? And he challenges me. And it's not in a demeaning way. It's not in a, it's in a, I'm your colleague, and we're going to kick some ass together. Seriously. That's what the energy he comes with. I don't need a room full of those. Because I would go cuckoo. So, however, I think be courageous about your board choices. Be courageous about how we push each other. Because the gifts that come out of that, there's innovation that comes out of that. So, at any rate, who do I need to get here? Let's really talk about this. Think about this. You know, we're building an orchestra here. Are all our instruments present and in tune? Or do we have some which I've had before too. And, you know, short answer to that, your board chair needs to step up and have a conversation with that person. That's what needs to happen. Mm-hmm. And your executive committee needs to step up and have a conversation with that person. It's not your job and it's not fair to you.
It's fine when your board chair is the bad actor. Not my current situation,
yeah.
But I've been there.
Yes. That's why we have executive committees. Yes, absolutely. Is there a diversity of sectors and voices? And in ALF, just because of the nature of what we do and what we're our mission, we define diversity in a lot of different ways. Political, ethnic diversity, age, sector. There is so much richness when you get people from different walks of life in the room. And leadership matters, right? So holding that container and leveraging that diversity is key in that. Because you can invite all sorts of people to the table, but are you including everybody? Is everybody talking? Does everybody have a voice? What's your retention rate? Pay attention to that, right? Do we meet too little or too often? When I came to ALF, there was no way I was going to be able to answer number two, who do I need to get there? The answer to that question did not jive with how often we were meeting. So I had to cut down to 5 meetings a year, and one was a holiday dinner. And so we meet quarterly. They're very substantial meetings. I'm not regurgitating committee minutes, and we're not, you know, it's not, okay, your turn to talk about the fundraising. That is not what it is. And I'll talk about meeting and meeting structure and kind of the arc of an inspiring meeting in a second. But that was a real consideration for me. Wow, I need to raise $1.4 million a year for my organization. I need some ask-getters on this board, and I need some names. They are not going to meet every month. You know, that's just not going to happen. So it's kind of considering, how does this match with what I need? And a very wise woman, a mentor to me, said the two most important people on your board are your board chair and your nominating or governance committee chair. And I haven't played at this kind of level of board before, quite honestly, right? I mean, the board that we have now, it's like, okay, I've got the COO of HP on my board. She's not meeting monthly, you know what I mean? And the nominating chair is the person that was really like, okay, how do we get the right people, the right combination, and how do we attract some of these big names to our board, right? So it's strategic. It's not, wow, we need, you know, this kind of person or that kind of person, or, oh God, who can make the meetings? No, 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 you should not start from the right place. Who do you need to get there? Having the courage to talk about that and face that's really important. Okay, the other question I like to ask, how many of us have served on boards, right? I like to ask myself, would I volunteer on this board? You know, I mean, quite honestly, would I make time to be here? Is this fun? Do I feel needed? Do I feel appreciated? Do I feel like I can contribute something? You know, am I included in conversations or am I asked to rubber stamp? You know? What would make me say yes to this opportunity? And what organizational culture do I thrive in? And so as an executive director, I've had to really, I've been doing this almost 20 years and I've, believe it or not, Brandy. Scary. Yeah, don't. It's his fault. Anyway. However, what I've had to really learn and hone, like I didn't walk in with this skill, is every member needs to be engaged. Like everybody needs a job. Everybody needs to feel needed. And that's work. So it's this interesting relationship, right? They're my bosses. And I've got to nurture that relationship. Like they're volunteers too. So how do we work together? What kind of a meeting do I want to co-create with my board chair and executive committee? It keeps people coming back. It keeps it worthwhile. So that's just another tool for your toolkit here about, you know, how do I attract people? Would I come to the party? Right? Board meetings. Let's talk. So I have the distinct pleasure of having this guy on my board. He's the CEO of the Audubon Society back in D.C. And he used to be the editor of Mercury News. His name's David Yarrow. And he would laugh if he saw that I had put this up here. But I remember he said to me, he's like, Suzanne, he's a very creative guy. Every board meeting needs to have an arc. It needs to have a narrative, a theme. Oh my God, what am I making a movie here? And you know what though? I really appreciated what you said because he has two or three board meetings a year and they're 3 days and there's like 60 board members, right? And he had one at the Computer History Museum recently. He goes, I want you to come to the meeting and watch it. I'm like, all right, I'll come drop by. Oh my God, I felt like I was at a conference and I was inspired and I left like, let's go fight climate change, you know? I mean, it was awesome. Now, are we gonna pull that off in 3 hours? Probably not. But it's the thinking around that. Like, this could be a really exciting opportunity. This could be a way that we all leave kind of pumped up, you know? And so, do we do a check-in in the beginning that gets us all present and in the room before we start talking about the financial statements? You know, do I know you as a person? Can we take 60 seconds each just to say, hey, here's where I'm at today, or here's what I'm walking into? What kind of professional development opportunities does your board have? You know, I had another board member who's like, you know, I know we've had to get, especially in the beginning, in the meat of operations, but we conduct a fellows class where we do all this interesting curriculum on here. Can we practice that for a half hour in our board meeting? I was like, duh, of course we can. That makes total sense. So we're doing a reading and discussing it at the board meetings. We're doing mindfulness and meditation at the board meetings, which is something that we do as a part of our class. It's creativity. And we're good at creativity. We're good at this, right? So I think, you know, a couple things. Survey your board, right? Are they having fun? Are they engaged? Is your board chair, nominating and governance chair saying, doing a survey every year of the boards, not just to say, what do you think of the executive director? No. How are we doing our job? How's the board doing? You know, do we show up to events? Are we fulfilling our part of this obligation? And part of that can be, are you, you know, that tells you if they're engaged. It tells you if they're here to warm a seat. It also tells you if they know what the mission statement is, right? Why are we here? So it's important for us to help co-create this and encourage this culture with our board chairs, right? Like, hey, let's get in and let's try and make sure folks are engaged. Secondly, you know, I have part of our executive committee, the structure we run is I meet with them a few weeks before the board meeting and then we say, okay, what are the big things we have to talk about? And what do we want to create together in this 3 hour meeting that we're gonna have? Because we only meet quarterly, right? It's gotta count. And so making sure that it's a participatory experience, it's not me shoving an agenda at people. That's not super exciting at all. They want to be a part of this. And if I'm doing most of the talking at the board meeting, it's not helpful. You know, it's not helpful. People are going, and I know it because I see people tuning out. Everyone's on their phone, you know, checking their watch. I want to access the wisdom in the room. You know, and I've had to change and evolve my thinking as an executive director around that. I've walked into meetings, boy, when I've had some tough folks to deal with where it's like, oh, it's gonna be a fight, you know? Or, okay, here's one approach I had as a young executive director when I first started. It was kind of like, I have to know everything, right? I have to know everything, and I have to show up, and I have to answer every question, and I do all my work, blah, 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 blah. Well, what does that leave any room for people to, for board members to contribute if I already know everything, right? So access the wisdom in the room. I mean, there's so much to be learned if we're open to listening. We're storytellers, for crying out loud. We can do this, you know? We like the conversation, so make sure there's room for everybody to participate. I think I'm almost done. I think this is second to last here. Board meetings, okay, relationship status. It's complicated. So the executive director's job and the board chair's role, you know, and for me, I continue to learn. I continue to learn what works well and what, this doesn't feel good. Am I overstepping? Is the board chair overstepping? In general, though, what I feel comfortable with and have learned and I've enjoyed and I feel is effective is part of my job is to make sure the board chair's engaged. You know, I mean, if that person's stepping into that role, man, we're going to have a serious conversation before. Hey, let's get on the same page about this. And, you know, I've had a lot of different board chairs in my career. One right now is a freaking poster child. have one executive director on the board, just a piece of advice.
Hallelujah.
Right? Because you have this other voice who's a board member that understands your sits in your shoes, right? And understands it. So anyway, he took me out to lunch and he said, "How can I help you? How can I help you? How can I be of service over the next year as your board chair?" I mean, I choke up thinking about it, right? That was beautiful. And he goes, "And part of my goals, this is what I want to do as a part of the board chair. I want to do major fundraising." You know, how many times have you heard that from a board chair? He was good at that. And he's like, "This is my commitment to you for a year. I'm going to help with this." So keeping my board chair engaged, are we in regular communication? Are expectations and needs clear? Transparency, man. This is a very important relationship for the health of the organization. Board chair's role, does your CEO feel supported? Have you asked? You know? Do you have a succession plan? Have you thought about that? And this one keeps coming up more and more to the... There's a nonprofit, I don't know if you guys have heard about this, but there is a organization that has come out to the Bay Area in the last couple of years that is, it's a foundation funding sabbaticals for nonprofit CEOs. You might be familiar with this. You know, we last about 4 years typically. That's like an average of executive directors. So that's no joke. I get headhunted all the time. I bet you get some of this too. In this area, oh my God, we have a pipeline problem. Big time. So I think it's really important as a board chair to nurture that relationship, man. Of course you're managing somebody, but you also want to be sure that they're not drowning, right? And what if you offered a sabbatical for 3 weeks or a month? You know, you've been here 5 years. Go take some time. I mean, imagine that refueling, right? So I think it's an interesting relationship. It can be a very powerful relationship. It can be toxic too. That's a whole other conversation about how you navigate that. But it's key, right? And finally, all these music references over here. Building a board never stops. We kind of stopped when I came to ALF because we had a lot of other things to care about, and then we went, oh my God, we're running behind. People are turning out, right? And I am not in favor of extending term limits for decades. I'm just not. You know, I mean, we're losing an opportunity to get new ideas in the room. So executive directors, try not to be afraid of that, man, because that there is goodness out there that you're not accessing when you close that door. So always be in the board building mode. There's always, you know, that's ongoing. For big culture lifts, culture shifts, make sure that, you know, you've got board allies and a team committed to this. And by that, I mean, wow, we now have to fundraise. Oh boy, this is a big deal. Let's get the executive committee, let's get the fundraising committee. Don't do it alone. That's not the point. The point of having the board is, you know, we are building this together. It's not just my responsibility as an individual. And these people show up once a month, right? So build your coalition and your support. And, you know, when things are in tune, boy, that's when your organization can really thrive. So that's my spiel. What's the point? So thank you.
A little bit about myself. I'm the Center for Excellence in Nonprofits based in Redwood City, as was mentioned. And I'm really loving how we are able to bring educational opportunities to nonprofit leaders from volunteers, board members, executive directors, staff. As a person who has had sort of a 360 experience in the nonprofit industry, I've benefited from nonprofits. I have been a volunteer, a board member, a program manager, an ED. And I bring to the table a perspective from all of those different lived experiences. And so when I was hearing you all go around, I was like, yeah, know that.
Yes.
I too had a BBB, we call it Boards Behaving Badly. You know, it's very real. And we're called, each one of you is doing such important work in your communities, and we're called to do it. Just such tight resources sometimes, and such strange circumstances around how we get it done. But magic happen, right? And I, like Suzanne here, I was at an organization that I had to build from the ground up. I basically had a board that came together around a table with a great idea. They brought me on and they said, hey, we got this idea, go do it.
all the instruction I got in